Our world is full of extremes. From the left to the right, this seems to be a common feature of our political, social, and religious world. The media plays this up. In fact, the media's focus on acts of terror, shootings, political one-upsmanship, etc., play to this ideology of extremes. In fact, it's hard not to believe that the media's attention on the terrible aspects of our world increases their likelihood. If every potential disgruntled youth with a gun knows that his or her name will live in infamy for at least a few days, is he or she not more likely to view this as a way to finally get some attention? And there's nothing in our modern world that faces the brunt of this ideology of the extreme than Islam. Within Islam is beset by extremist groups misinterpreting a message of peace and warping it to their own ends. And from without, politicians paint Islam as a religion that only knows war and must therefore be met by war. But our guest today knows better. Salam Badi is a spokesperson for the Ahmadiyya Muslim Community USA. He joins us today to balance the message of extreme Islam with an Islam of peace and acceptance. Welcome, Salam.
Thanks, Tabitha. Good to be here again.
Oh, always a pleasure to have you on. Salam, you know, now over the past few years, we've seen the media repeatedly portray Islam as a religion connected to violence, either through terrorism in the West or because of the wars raging in Syria and Libya, for example. But there is a different story. Martin O'Malley, former candidate for president and governor of Maryland in early August, attended the 60th annual convention of the Ahmadiyya Muslim Community in the USA. Tell us about that event, what its goals, purposes, and what were the contents of O'Malley's speech there, and do you think they spoke to Islam as a religion of peace?
So we just had the 68th annual convention of the Ahmadiyya Muslim Community here in America. And let's not take that lightly. We've had an American Muslim convention going on for 68 years in this country, and it's a completely peaceful community event. The goals are two. One is to spiritually rejuvenate the members of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, and secondly is to increase the bonds of brother and sisterhood amongst the community. And that's what keeps us so strong and so connected to our community and so knowledgeable about what Islam is all about, which is peace and justice on every level. Now, with former Governor Martin O'Malley there, he straight off the board talked about how True Islam, the campaign that we have, is a gift to America. And he's seen the 11 points and how he enjoys how it talks to charity and being good to others on a universal level. And he pointed out that TrueIslam.com is a wonderful thing for this country, and he encourages everybody to check it out.
That's interesting.
No, there was actually a similar event in England in mid-March. This was the 50th such event, and it was reported, not that a lot of mainstream media reported it, that 30,000 people were in attendance, along with your leader, if I'm saying it correctly, the Khalifa of the Ahmadiyya movement. What was the message that he was bringing to that? And what did he have to say about, you know, terrorism, the threat from ISIS, the kind of things that are sort of being thrown at Americans every day when they turn on the television?
So His Holiness the Khalifa of Islam, Mirza Masroor Ahmad, addressed over 40,000 Ahmadi Muslims as well as non-Muslim guests and over 500,000 people who were watching around the world just last week at this annual convention. And he said that these injustices around the world are occurring because we are not taking care of our own within our own homes. And he highlighted that Islam is a religion about justice on every level. And he's been talking about this for over the past 10 years, where he says that we need to have justice on every level so that we can have a path to peace. Over the weekend, he spoke about how we need to have justice in our own homes. Parents need to be loving and caring towards their children. And likewise, once children have grown up and their parents are older, they need to take care of their parents. If this justice is not happening, then we can see what has happened in the state of the world. If we cannot take care of those in our own homes, as your previous report talked about with Native Americans and blacks in America, then we'll see these injustices just branch out into so much more cruelty in the world. So we really need to correct this at home.
You know, it's interesting. Recently, an imam and his assistant were shot in broad daylight in New York City. Now, the suspect's in custody. There's no word on whether or not this was religiously motivated or a hate crime. It certainly could be that. Nevertheless, many are likely to draw connections between, you know, the hateful rhetoric spewed by politicians and pundits at times and attacks like these. As a Muslim, when you hear of an attack, what is your immediate reaction? And are Muslim communities, do they feel threatened in the United States when you hear so much anti-Islamic sentiment?
Well, we're aware that 60% of Americans don't know a Muslim, and we are aware that such ignorance can lead to misunderstanding and to fear, which leads to hate, which leads to hateful actions. And in Queens, where I'm from as well, where there is a rise in Islamophobia. I mean, I myself, when I was exiting the mosque, have been the subject of some Islamophobia. So it's disheartening, but we know that we're not going to rely on these few extremes, these few extremists, to paint a broad brush over all of America. We know that Americans aren't like this, and we're going to continue using proven models like the True Islam Campaign to educate our neighbors and our friends and our fellow Muslims and non-Muslims as to what Islam's true teachings are. You know, in the face of hate, we're not going to give in to hate. That's what the extremists want. They want more extremism to grow and to build so that they can have a self-fulfilling truth. But we're better than that, and we're going to keep the doors to our mosques open, and we invite everybody, whether you're Mr. Trump or whether you're any type of voter or citizen, come to our mosques, check them out, read a Quran. You can always get a free Quran at muslimsforpeace.org, free shipping as well, and check out what the Quran says for yourself.
Well, let me ask you this. You brought up the election. How should those of us in the community who are not Muslim, how should we view this race for president through a Muslim's eyes? I mean, do you think there's a major difference between the foreign policy of the two candidates?
When looking at this political election, we need to look at which candidate will offer the most justice. You know, there's a lot of empty rhetoric going on, especially when it comes to this ideology of radical Islam. And we can't be so fixated on saying this term of radical Islam because it's just not a truth. You know, there's radicalism and there's Islam. Those two are very different things. Just as we're not going to say that the KKK is radical Christianity, we shouldn't be going around saying that these extremist groups are radical Islam. It, in fact, is dangerous to the Muslims who are doing so many great things here in America to conflate them in with such a terrible group of extremists.
It is a very difficult situation, I think, because it's hard with some of the crop of leaders that we have out there. It's really hard to kind of cut through the rhetoric of okay, who, is this person saying this to score points with a certain voting base, and or do they really believe that? Or is this person truly someone who actually believes the kind of, you know, rhetoric that you hear? You know, you've said over and over, and we all know that Islam itself is a religion of peace. Almost every religion is. But I have to ask, you know, very quickly, why are we seeing, is it because of a breakdown in family, or why are we seeing, you know, young Muslims around the world become radicalized? Like, what is the causes, in your opinion, that happens, and what can we quickly do to stop it?
His Holiness actually spoke exactly to this point at the UK convention. He said that if parents are not teaching their children what Islam is actually about, then these children will join these extremist groups. So it comes right down to education. Whether you're a Muslim or a non-Muslim, education will take away extremism. And that's the core, the crux of the TrueIslam.com campaign. And I cannot highlight this enough, how important it is that we go on a grassroots level, you and me, Tyrell, Tabitha, all the viewers, that we let people know that extremism has no place in our society, and we will educate it away.
You know, that's really interesting you say education, because education is the key to many, many problems in this world. It's a key to education gets rid of bigotry, education gets rid of extremism, and education gets rid of fear at the end of the day. And I think it would be really important for us to focus on that for a change instead of just spewing rhetoric as always. Salam Bhatti, thank you very much for coming on the show today. Always indeed a pleasure to have you on. Keep up the good work out there.
Thanks so much, guys.